Merry Christmas, everyone! May muntag sa tanan. I hope you're excited to be here. Pwede niyo bang batiin yung katabi ninyo? From afar, tell that person, I'm so glad you are my seatmate today. First Sunday of December, last month of the year. Are you excited to finish strong, everyone? You see, the whole year, it has been challenging for most of us, for many of us, and it's not been easy. In fact, for many of us, I've had some conversations with some of our church members, and there's just the reality that it's not really a bed of roses, but a lot of times there are thorns along the way. Some of you are still walking in the desert, and sometimes you're still asking, Lord, hanggang kailan to? But the good news is that we serve a faithful God. And the reason why you're here today, you may be barely just holding on, but understand that the God who called you is faithful to finish what He started in your life. Now again, can you just encourage the person seated next to you, kahit malayo, tell that person, God is faithful. Come on, go ahead. Now, how many hearing that you're just encouraged, just parang understanding that the God that we serve, the God that we worship is a faithful God. One of the things that I really love about God is that we can never limit His faithfulness in our lives. Just this week, I celebrated my 23rd birthday. All right. Maraming salamat sa mga naniwala. Kidding aside, I celebrated my 37th birthday and it was actually a reason to celebrate. You see, as we're starting a brand new series on a reason to celebrate, I want all of us to understand that it is possible to live a life that despite of the tragedies, the difficulties, the problems that we face, that we can live a life that celebrates the goodness and faithfulness of God. In short, regardless of how difficult our circumstance may be, it does not limit or it does not control the magnificence and the greatness of God in our lives. And I love this series because it reminds us that even as we enter this Christmas season, it's not just about celebrating a day, but celebrating the goodness of Jesus sa buhay ng bawat isa. And as we get into the Word of God, I hope and pray that we would just really allow God to speak to us, that we would allow God to really minister to us today. Because for many of us, even as we go through our year, there have been circumstances that have, in some ways, it has changed the way we view not just Christmas, but life itself. You see, as I celebrated my birthday this week, I pondered about a lot of things. And one of the things is that the way I celebrate. Growing up, I love celebrating with many, many people. The people person that I am, gustong-gusto ng maraming tao, the more the many years. Sino dito, you can relate with that. Oh, di ba yung para bang dalawang tao, nasistress ka na dahil, but I love, kapag mas marami, mas mabuti. I remember I celebrated one birthday wherein I had like 220 guests, parang kasal. And yet I was like, wow! Alam mo, pagkatapos ng party, sabi ko, I told my parents, Mom, Dad, my heart is so full kasi ang daming tao eh. That's the kind of person that I am. But the older I get, the more that my preferences about celebration has changed. Maybe because there were circumstances, there were situations in life that made me realize na mas better pa na konti na yung tao. And sometimes, because of what we go through in life, it affects or it impacts the way we view celebration. And for even as we think of Christmas, some people, I would hear statements where people would say, ang Christmas, pang bata lang yan. Pang, hindi niya pang matanda. Because for most people, sa mga nag-adulting, sinasabi nila, I have to think about the bills. I have to think about anything else. I have to think about the responsibilities. Ang Christmas, pambata lang. Have you heard of that statement? When I was growing up, I was like, wow, Christmas is the best season. September pa lang, di ba? Parang nag-celebrate na sa mga malls. And even in our nation, we celebrate it. And we even have memes about Jose Marichan singing and just trying to prepare us for the Christmas season. But somehow, because of the things that we've experienced in life, the way we view, the way we see, the lens that we're looking at Christmas, it has diminished. For some reason, we're not excited about Christmas anymore. For some reason, what excites us during Christmas season is the Christmas bonus or the 13th month, or maybe the extended sleep, or maybe the Christmas holidays. You see, there is a reason for us to celebrate. The very fact, the very truth that we're here today, we get to hear the Word of God, we get to worship God, is a reason to celebrate. But more importantly, the Word of God has something to say for us to celebrate His faithfulness and His goodness in our lives. Now I want to invite everyone to please stand up and open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. We'll be reading just one verse, but later on we'll be jumping a couple of verses later on. Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14. Can we all read together? Verse 14 says here, "Therefore the Lord Himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." Can we all read together? Go. "Therefore the Lord Himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son and shall call his name Emmanuel." Let us pray. Lord, thank you for your faithfulness in our lives. Lord, if there's one thing that we are celebrating today, it is you. Your goodness, your mercy, your love, Lord, your grace, Lord, the gifts that you have given to every single one of us. Yes, Lord, we desire for your blessings. Lord, we desire for protection. But more importantly, God, our prayer is that we would discover more of who you are. Lord, that we would get to enjoy, Lord, what you have in store, but more importantly, who you really are in our lives. And even, Lord, as we're celebrating this Christmas season, Lord, we are reminded of you. We are reminded of your goodness. We are reminded, God, of everything that you have done, given for us. So, Lord, thank you. And Holy Spirit, as we discuss about your word, even as we worship you together today, I pray that you would speak to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please be seated, everyone. So, Isaiah chapter 7, we may have heard this verse that talks about God with us. But Isaiah chapter 7 actually starts with an alliance between the king of Pekah and the king of Israel. Now, the king of Judah at that time was Ahaz. Okay, pangalan pa lang noon, napaka-Ahaz na talaga. And Ahaz actually was a wicked king. But his father and his grandfather, remember King Uzziah, and they were righteous kings and people celebrated their goodness. But King Ahaz, on the other hand, he was actually a wicked king. He turned away from the Lord. Everything that his parents built, everything that his grandfather and father built, he started to walk in his own ways, which was actually in the wicked way. Now, as the king of Judah, he made things, he led without God in his leadership. And so what happened here was that the king of Israel and the king of Pekah, they made an alliance against King Ahaz. And so what happened here was that Ahaz and the people of Judah, they started to get scared. They were afraid because Judah had this history of being conquered by other nations and they don't have the capacity to win against other nations. So as the king of Israel and Pekah, as they joined together, ang iniisip ni King Ahaz is that I will ally myself with a different nation. And so what he did was he actually, okay, allied himself, he made an ally with Assyria, which was a pagan nation, which was a nation that conquered them already. And so if you look at the story here, Ahaz was in a dilemma. In fact, he became king at the age of 20 years old. And looking at the story here, they were in a national crisis because there was a threat that was about to enter their nation. They were about to experience something that's devastating. And for the situation of Ahaz here, he did not know what he was supposed to do. So the only thing reasonable na gagawin niya was to actually ally himself with a pagan nation. Because he was someone who did not follow God in his life. So when trouble came knocking, what Ahaz did was to do something that was not spiritual. And that was expected for someone who had no relationship with God. In fact, the summary of his life, if you look at scriptures, the summary statement of his life and reign says it all, that he did not do what was right in the eyes of the Lord his God. But despite of his rebellion, despite of his wickedness, alam niyo, napakabuti pa rin ni God. In fact, God told Isaiah, God sent Isaiah to King Ahaz to give him a word. And as Isaiah spoke the word of God to Ahaz, very interesting po yung naging response ni Ahaz. And so God gave three promises to King Ahaz. The first promise is that these two kings who are conniving against you, they will be no more. In fact, the specific description is that they will be smoldering stubs of firewood. It's like a campfire. Have you ever tried yung may campfire, yung bonfire? And then of course, lumiliyab siya. But the following day, what you will just see is simply ashes. And God promised that these people who are threatening against you, they will become like ashes. And 2 years after the prophecy was given, guess what? These two kings who threatened against Ahaz actually died. Amazing. Second promise that God gave to Ahaz was this, that the attack that was about to take place in their nation, it's not going to happen. And true enough, it did not happen. That the threats coming from the king of Israel did not ever happen. But there was also this startling, this very interesting prophecy or promise that Isaiah gave to King Ahaz. Ano yun? That in 65 years, their nation will be gone. And guess what? As God promised, it was fulfilled. Because of Judah's continuous rebellion and wickedness, 65 later, their nation was actually gone. In the sense that they were exiled. That people were moved into a different nation. And the final word that Isaiah gave to Ahaz was this, stand firm in the Lord. Trust in who God is. Believe in God because He is the God who delivered your forefathers. But here's what's interesting. Despite of how God has given His promises to Ahaz, did you know how Ahaz responded? He still responded in disobedience. And here's what I love about God. That regardless of our responses, God always has a word for you in the day of your trouble. Imagine Ahaz was in a national crisis. He did not know what he was supposed to do. He didn't know what's the right thing to do. That instead of running to God, he still ran towards those people who will bring destruction to him. And this is what I love about God, that in the day of our trouble, God will always speak a word of encouragement. God will always speak a word of life. God will always remind us of His promises. God will always remind us of His love, His mercy, His grace in our lives. And this, in this very difficult and challenging moment in the life of Ahaz, the Lord spoke to him. Now, have there been times in our lives where we were disobedient and we were rebellious against God, and yet in the faithfulness of God, in the mercy of God, the word of the Lord was given to us? I remember a story of one person, and he was living a very sinful life. And no one was just really correcting him. Kasi alam niyo sa mga magbabarkada, na siya yung bully, siya yung laging, ay nako, di magbabago yan. Ay nako, ganun talaga yung buhay niya. Walang patutunguhan yung buhay niya. And one day, he had this one friend. Anong sinabi lang sa kanya? Oye, alam mo bro, kung di ka magbabago, siguro, maybe a year from now, wala ka na dito sa mundo. Yun yung sinabi sa kanya. That's the only thing that was said to him. Alam mo, kung di ka magbago, probably a year from now, wala ka na dito sa mundo. And that word, actually, alam yung natakot siya, and it caused him to really take life seriously. And that was actually the beginning of him pursuing a life with God. You see, the Word of God is never limited by our circumstances. Sometimes, tayo yung namimili, Lord, makihinig lang ako sa iyo, Lord, kapag may blessings, kapag Christmas na, kapag ganito yung mangyayari sa buhay ko. But God always has a word for us in the day of our trouble. And in this very situation, what the prophet Isaiah was telling King Ahaz is that the Lord wants to deliver you. And then, even Isaiah was saying, Ahaz, why don't you even test the Lord? And then, Ahaz said something, that I will not test the Lord. Sino ba naman ako para i-test si God? But Isaiah was saying, the Lord is faithful. In fact, then in verse 14 of chapter 7, Isaiah just gave this very powerful verse, this statement, that until today we get to really celebrate it. And he said, therefore, the Lord himself will give you a sign. Now, sino sa atin dito mahilig tayo ng sign? Anong typical na sign, Lord? Bigyan mo ako ng sign, Lord, if pupunta ako ng church today. Like, Lord, bigyan mo ako ng sign if manliligaw na ako or hindi. Lord, bigyan mo ako ng sign, Lord, kung papasok ako sa business transaction na to or hindi. Lord, bigyan mo ako ng sign, Lord, kung matutulog na ako or hindi. Biglang nag-brown out. Lord, matutulog na ako. A lot of times, we look for signs for us to do things. Now, if you look at the Bible, God actually gives signs. But when God gives signs, it is to arrest our attention. For us to understand that God is capable of doing things according to His will. Thus, if you look at, remember the 10 plagues that Moses performed in front of Pharaoh, it is for Pharaoh to understand that God is powerful and able to accomplish His plans and purpose, not only to the life of His people, but to show people that God is greater than anything that we embrace in our lives. Not only that, a sign is a something that God gives to it's used to prove that God is able to accomplish His will in our lives. It is to point that God is faithful. But at the same time, church, let me also remind everyone that we don't need a sign for everything. Intindihan natin? We don't need a sign for everything. Like, I remember one time, there was this one person who lumapit, Pastor, may nanliligaw sa akin. Sabi ko, okay. And then, sabi, paano ko malaman yung sign na kung sasagutin ko siya or hindi? Sabi ko, kung ayaw mo sa kanya, di huwag mo sagutin, that's the sign. Sabi niya, pero Pastor, ganito. Sabi ko lang, alam mo, sometimes we over-spiritualize things. But if you want really a sign, then first and foremost, just try to know the character of the person. Is this person loving Jesus? Is this person faithful to God? Then those are the things that you need to look for. But everyone, you don't need a sign for everything. But the reason why the prophet Isaiah was talking about a sign here, it is for King Ahaz to understand that there is a God who is calling him to lead him, to worship him. And yet what's happening here is that King Ahaz, he was still looking at a blind eye despite of all the things that God had been giving and revealing to him. And what is the sign? Isaiah was saying here, behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son. Isn't this interesting? Now, of all the signs na pwedeng gawin ni God, pwede nang sabihin that there will be a fire from heaven and that will fall. And you will see this temple being built up. But the sign that the prophet Isaiah was saying is that a virgin shall conceive and bear a son. And if you're looking at it, there is such impossibility for a virgin, someone who had no sexual relations, someone who is pure, and yet for this virgin to conceive and bear a child, that is impossible, friends. And yet what God was telling Isaiah, what God was telling Ahaz, is that I am the cause. I will be the reason for impossible things to take place. And mind you, everyone, regardless of how impossible situations may be, regardless of how impossible our future may look like, understand that we have a God who specializes in the impossible. Yet there are so many times, even the little details in our lives, we worry about it. Yet here, God was telling Ahaz, I got you. Something supernatural can take place. And this is the sign that God was giving to Ahaz. Regardless of the response of Ahaz, God was faithful in keeping His promise. In fact, it says here, and shall call His name Emmanuel. The word Emmanuel simply means God with us, or a strong God with us. In short, in our moments of weaknesses, imagine this, in this moment where Ahaz was at his weakest, he was in a crisis, he was looking for a different solution, yet God, in His goodness, promised him that I will be with you, that my strong presence is with you, that my strong hand is with you, that my power is upon you. Yet he did not recognize all of those. And this is the goodness of God. The Emmanuel, God dwelt among us. That Jesus became one of us. And I want us to understand these three words. God who is powerful, that God who is great, that the God who is merciful, that the God who is gracious is with us. When you talk about with us, kasama mo. Hindi yung, have you ever had friends who will tell you, I will always be here for you? But in those very difficult moments, you can't even feel them. You can't even experience their presence. But with God, He did not just say it. He actually demonstrated it. So in some sense, what God was telling Ahaz is that, Ahaz, don't give up hope. Ahaz, don't lose sleep over what you're going through. What God was saying is that, Ahaz, I know malaki yung pinagdadaanan mo, but I am the God who will rescue you. But what God is asking, worship me, love me, serve me, be obedient to my commands. And what's beautiful about this scripture, is that Ahaz actually refused to listen to the voice of God. Ahaz refused to put his trust and faith in God. Yet, God kept His promises anyway. God did not withdraw His promise because of the king's unfaithfulness. You see, church, men, they buckle under pressure. Men betray one another. Men might break their promises, but not God. God remained with His people. God remained with a faithless king, and God keeps His promises. In fact, if you look at Matthew chapter 1, verses 21 to 23, it says here, "She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet." Verse 23, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel," which means God with us. Did you know that from Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, until Matthew chapter 1, there was a difference of 700 years? Kaya niyo ba mag-antay ng 700 years? Siguro ang theme song ng mga Israelites ito is yung, "I have died, wait." Ano yung kanta niyan? Yun na yun siya. Hindi pala kanta yung tula. Okay, tula pala yung ginawa ko. But it took like 700 years for the people of Israel just to see the fulfillment of the promise. Now, many were waiting and many were expecting, but there were people wherein they felt abandoned. They felt lost. And the Israelites wandered around. You see, when we celebrate Christmas, Christmas is a powerful reminder that God is with us. And when you talk about God with us, what does it mean? Three important things. First is this. Christmas, or God with us, simply means that it's a promise fulfilled. That when God promised to a wicked king, to a rebellious king, that I will be with you, that God actually fulfilled His promise. That God promised a deliverer, and guess what? God delivered on His promise. God gave us not just a king, but a savior who would deliver us from the dominion of sin in our lives. Matthew records the fulfillment of God's promise of a savior for mankind. You see, the Jews waited for God to fulfill His promise, and they were waiting. But most of the time, when people wait, they demand God to do things according to their desires. But understand that God does not move in accordance to the timeline of man. Because all of us, at most, maybe we can live up to 100 years, but God is eternal. God has already been there since the beginning, even until the end of time. We have to understand that God is someone who works according in His own purposes, in accordance to His own will. Yet many of us, when we pray to God, we demand God, Lord, I want you to do this for me. Most of the time, our problem is one word: impatience. Impatience. Now, I won't ask you who is the most impatient person that you know, because that could actually be yourself. Because of our impatience, we impatiently ask God to accomplish our plans. Because of our impatience, we do things without God's counsel. Do you know what impatience reveals about us? Our lack of trust in God's timing and ability. But God gives His promise because He knows best. And what He wants from us is our trust. Do you know, for God to fulfill His promise, it was at a cost. And do you know what the cost is? The life of His beloved Son, Jesus Christ. Yet, in His glory, in His goodness, alam mo ginawa ni God? He gave His one and only Son out of love so that His promise will be fulfilled. Not only is that God with us a promise fulfilled, but it's also the presence of God experienced. Remembering the stories in the Bible where Adam was walking alongside with God? Remember the story where God just revealed His presence to Moses? Remember the story in the Bible where God was talking with Abraham as a man would talk to his friend? Remember the story where Elijah had this encounter with God in the mountain? There were stories in the Bible where titingnan mo parang, Lord, sana all. Sana lahat nakakausap ka, Lord. Sana, Lord, yung we experience namin yung presence mo. Yet God, when He said that God will be with us, the word Emmanuel it's literally that God would go into the form of man, and what would happen is that He will dwell among us. And you see, so many people, iniisip nila, that the more that they are religious, that the more that they would sing worship songs, that the more that they will experience God. But experiencing God is not something about what we do, it's about what God has already done. And more than 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ came into the world so that we may experience the goodness of God, the fullness of His salvation, so that all of us will be walking in the purposes of God. So when we talk about God with us, we're talking about truly experiencing God in His goodness, in His mercy, in His grace. Every moment, every second of our lives, it means that we are never alone. And lastly, when we talk about God with us, it's about the person of Christ revealed. You see, it wasn't just a prophecy that was given. It was about the Christ revealed. That Jesus became one of us, lived with us, felt like us, and alam nyo, He suffered like us. Kung isip natin, have you ever felt like life is so difficult? Minsan akala natin na napakabigat ng pinagdadaanan natin, that when you compare your story with someone else's story, parang, grabe, alam mo, yung problema mo is nothing compared to my problem. But if kung alam mo yung pagalingan or pahirapan na ng story, I would actually think that Jesus suffered the most. Why? Imagine He is God. In the presence of His Father in heaven, where everything is glorious, everything is perfect, where everything, in His holiness, angels were worshiping Him. Yet, what Jesus did was to willingly submit to the plan of His Father, to come here in this broken world, to suffer like man, and to suffer for the sins of man. For what purpose? For you and I to be saved. Isn't that suffering, church? And if you just compare the vast difference of the kind of suffering that we're going through, yes, mahirap pumunta ng church na nakamask. Yes, mahirap pumunta ng mall na nakamask. Yes, mahirap yung pandemic wherein you cannot just really fellowship with anyone else. But understand today that Jesus suffered like us, amongst us. And he experienced the most brutal, the most excruciating, the most humiliating form of punishment during that time, which was crucifixion. Yet what God did, what Jesus did, was he willingly submitted to his Father's plan to save mankind and to make his Father's glory known. In John chapter 1, verse 14, it says here, the Word became flesh and made His dwelling among us. Jesus became one of us. Now it says here, we have seen His glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father full of grace and truth. What I love about this is that Jesus Christ came here for us to experience these two important things, grace and truth. And when we talk about the grace of God, we're talking about something that we did not deserve. The life that we have right now is something that we do not deserve. The salvation that we have right now, it's something that we did not deserve. And we have experienced this because Christ came here so that you and I might experience His grace. But not only that, for us to experience and to know the truth as well. What God wants for us is not to follow Him blindly. Because it is possible that you can say, you can tell people, Merry Christmas, and yet you're celebrating something else. That's why Jesus Christ came here, so that we would have a reason to celebrate. For us to know His truth, and for us to experience His grace. You see, this pandemic, we may have had those moments where it was very hard for us to hear God. We may have had these moments where it's difficult to understand God. Then we realize a lesson on Christmas Day. That Jesus came not a time where when people were prepared. God is not expecting us to be ready when He would accomplish His plans in our lives. Because it's about Him. You see, Christmas is God-focused, not self-focused. It's not about us. And the question is how we come to a point when we have made our times with God about us instead of Jesus. My prayer is that may our revelation of who Jesus is point us to Him. May we, as we understand that God is with us, may we understand that He actually has already done what needs to be accomplished so that all of us might experience and enjoy the life that He has intended for every one of us. And my prayer, church, is this. My prayer is that more than just the gifts that we get to receive, more than just the emotions natin, my prayer is that we would worship God for who He is. That we would discover what He has done for every single one of us. Let us pray. Lord, thank You. Lord, thank You, God, for pouring out Your love and Your mercy to every single one of us. Lord, thank You. Because You have been so, so good in our lives. And Lord, today we say thank You. We say thank You, Lord, because You are the God who fulfilled Your promise to us. Lord, even if You can give this promise, this sign, Lord, to a rebellious, wicked king. Lord, and not only did you just give this promise, but You also fulfilled it. And You fulfilled it, Lord, not because we're good, but because You are a good God. You are a trustworthy God. You are a faithful God. And Lord, thank You that even if we were unworthy, You fulfilled Your promise. Lord, You gave Your Son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins. Lord, You gave Your Son Jesus, Lord, for us to experience, Lord, what this life with You will look like. So Lord, today we just want to repent, Lord, of our sins, of those moments that we have turned away from You. Lord, we want to say sorry, God, and we repent, Lord, for those moments that we have rebelled against You. Lord, we want to say sorry, Lord, for those moments that we thought that yung iniisip namin, yung akala namin, yun yung tama. But Lord, we want to say sorry. Sorry, Lord, for we thought, Lord, that we were right. But Lord, it ended up us leading, walking away farther from you. So Lord, we're making this decision today, Lord, to walk towards you. We may not be able to run, God, but Lord, we're walking, God, towards you so that we can walk beside you, Lord, with you in our lives. At the same time, Lord, maraming salamat because you have just given us this very wonderful life. This wonderful life, Lord, not driven by our selfishness, not driven by our greed, but Lord, driven by you, led by you. So Lord, I pray for every single one of us, Lord, to those who are watching, worshiping with us online, and to those who are here right now in this church. Lord, even as you have revealed yourself to us, I pray that we will all the more recognize your work, that all the more we will worship you, that all the more, God, we will glorify you in our lives. Lord Jesus, thank you. And Lord, we honor you today. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Can we all stand up, everyone? And as before we end, my quick encouragement is that this month, more than just being expectant of Christmas parties and exchange gifts, I pray that you would all the more pursue a relationship with Christ. Don't get caught up in the hype, in the busyness of the world. Take time to really get into the Word of God. And at the same time, get into really this moment of worship before God. You see, every day there's a reason to celebrate. It's not just because of the circumstances around us, but because we have a great and good God. Amen. Can we all lift up our hands before God? Lord, thank you for your mercy and your grace in our lives. Lord, maraming salamat. Lord, because you who started a good work in our lives, Lord, will complete it. Lord, we are expectant, Lord, of what you will do in and through our lives. So, Lord, I pray that you bless your people. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Jesus, you are our peace. You are our Lord. You are our Master. And we worship you. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Everyone say, amen and amen. Amen. Thank you, everyone, for worshiping with us. God bless you. See you again next Sunday.